morning. We'll continue our discussion with linear random processes. So what we shall do today is go over the definition of this linear random process a bit more in detail. As you saw yesterday and also as you see on the screen today, the definition has certain restrictions, right, on the driving force as well as the coefficients. We'll discuss the restriction on the coefficient a bit more in detail and then move on to discuss a class of processes which we have already seen earlier, which are the moving average processes, and again examine such models more in detail today. And as I said, we'll talk about the issue of invertibility. Fine. So let's look at this definition that we have for a linear random process. And yesterday we did talk about its strong similarities with that of the convolution equation that you see in deterministic world. I'll just write that by the side for your convenience. And this is not surprising because we have already said that the idea of developing a time series model amounts to imagining Vk to be driven by white noise, that is a linear time invariant filter driven by white noise. So obviously, the moment you say LTI systems, you should expect the convolution equation to come in, and that is what has happened. But the big difference, as I said yesterday, is that this convolution equation is derived from the from the property of linearity and time invariance. Whereas very often the definition of a linear random process itself is given in this form. So the definition of a linear random process is tied to this this representation itself. And of course, when you move to the nonlinear world, then you have to worry more about what are the other representations and so on. But since we are in the linear world, we will work only with this definition. And as we have noticed, in general, we also allow future shock waves to affect Vk, but very soon we will restrict the summation such that n equals 0. In other words, we will only allow causal models. So you see this restriction here, that of course we have also said that the driving force should be white noise, but let us add the Gaussian to it. And as I mentioned earlier, in many texts, particularly on nonlinear time series analysis and a few on linear time series analysis, you would see this Ek being represented restricted to IID sequences. Okay, but we know that the Gaussian white noise is also an IID, so we are not really violating this particular requirement. Anyway, if you look at the history of time series modeling, one of the major contributors was Bartlett. And if you go to Bartlett's definition of a linear random process, you would see that the restriction of Ek is on IIDs, not on the white noise as such. But gradually people replace this with white noise. Now it is okay, because anyway, we are only worried about the second order stationarity, right? And white noise is anyway a second order stationary uncorrelated process. Now, the more serious part, of course, I mean, I am not saying this is not such serious, but the more serious part is on the restrictions of the coefficients. Here, you may choose to switch between Gaussian white noise and IID, but if you look at this sequence here, n is just a dummy variable, we have required that this sequence here is absolutely convergent. Now let us talk a bit on this requirement of absolute convergence of the coefficients. We have already seen this kind of a requirement here. We have said for stability, one requires the impulse response coefficients to be absolutely convergent, right? Here there is no notion of stability, but we have this issue of stationarity and so on. So if you read stability loosely, essentially what it amounts to saying is any bounded input should produce a bounded output, That is the kind of stability we are discussing here. Here, one of the requirements of Vk, for Vk to be stationary, is that Vk should be bounded. For example, magnitude of Vk should always be less than some finite value. But since Vk is a random variable, we do not talk about magnitude of Vk, we talk of expectation of magnitude of Vk, right. So, that is one of the requirements, although that is not the only requirement for stationarity. So, if you look at it from that viewpoint, then this condition here guarantees, that is fairly easy to prove. You actually take the magnitude on both sides, apply expectations, and then use the Cauchy-Schwarz or the triangular inequality to show that if this is satisfied, then this is guaranteed. Okay. In fact, that is one, that is also the way that one proves boundedness of yk in the deterministic world. The only difference is, in the deterministic world, we do not take expectations, all right. So, we will not prove that. This proof is available in many texts, including the book by Brockwell and Davis and so on. Now, the other requirement, remember we said Vk should be stationary. Of course, we can straight away see that the expectation of Vk is 0, given that Eks are 0 mean variables. It is likely that the process that you are looking at does not have a 0 mean. In that case, what do you do? Right? All you have to do is replace Vk with Vk minus mu, assuming it to be stationary already. So, the model would be for Vk minus mu in place of Vk. That is the only difference. In other words, you are going to add a constant to the right hand side. That is another way of looking at it. So, we will not worry about that. It does not spoil any of the results that we are discussing. So, coming back to the discussion, we know that if Vk were to be stationary, which is actually guaranteed by this, then expectation of Vk is 0. So, that is the first condition of second order stationarity is satisfied, or the Weitzen stationarity is satisfied. What is the second condition? Variance should be finite, right. Now, we want sigma square V to be less than infinity. It turns out that, again, this condition guarantees this. I am not going to prove it, but it is fairly easy to see that. See, first of all, what would be variance of V? What is the expression for sigma square V? Right. This is what you meant? Times? Right, correct. So, sigma square E is anyway given to be finite. So, the finiteness of sigma square V solely depends on this. Now, we know from the theory of sequences, right, properties of sequences, that if a sequence is absolutely convergent, then the square is also convergent, not the other way around, right. You should recall these properties of sequences, that absolute summability does guarantee the summability of the squared one. In fact, I do not even need to use the magnitude here, because it is going to be squared, and we are only anyway dealing with real valued sequences here. So, this implies the convergence of this sequence, but not the other way around. In fact, in many textbooks, you will see a slightly diluted version of this requirement for linear random processes. That is, instead of placing this restriction, you will find this to be the requirement. It does not take away too much from the definition of the linear random process, but this is a stronger requirement, and I will tell you why it is stronger requirement. So, you understand now that the variance is obviously going to be finite, whether this holds or this holds. Now, what is the third requirement for stationarity? the autocovariance should be independent of lag L, and it also should be bounded, right? And in the sense, autocovariance cannot run away at any other lag. Since we have proved variance to be bounded, the autocovariance also will be bounded. Remember, the maximum value of autocovariance is at lag 0. So you can prove that the autocovariance, in fact, in many textbooks, instead of proving variance to be bounded, you would actually require that the autocovariance be bounded. But there is a more important requirement that we are forgetting. Anyway, so we will talk about that soon. First is that the conditional expectation, the expectation of the absolute value should be bounded, and you can prove that again invoking this requirement. It is very hard to use this requirement there. And you can prove that the variance is bounded using one of these requirements. As a result, autocovariance is also bounded. But there is another important and an even more important requirement. We will first talk about the another important one. Remember, we said we can write the definition, we can think of this representation only for processes with what property? That is okay. That is going to give me guarantee optimality. So, the jointly Gaussian requirement is for optimality, so that the conditional expectation and this linear predictor or linear representation will give me same predictions. But my ability that to form such a representation for Vk rests on some condition on the autocovariance. Absolutely convergent, right? We have said that. We have said that the spectral density should satisfy certain conditions. But firstly, a spectral density should exist, and for the spectral density to exist, like we said yesterday, the autocovariance function should be absolutely convergent. So you need also to show that sigma mod sigma L should be bounded. Of course, I have dropped a subscript, but this is the requirement that we need to guarantee, and it turns out that this guarantees absolute convergence as well. And you again, a proof of this is available. For example, you can see the text in Hamilton. I will see if I can upload the proof on the slides, but we will not spend time in the class proving these things. This is for your information, in the sense to understand why this, there is so much why this requirement is necessary and in how many different ways this is essential, right? Now, there is an even more important requirement, which is that this summation here that we are looking at, first of all, should converge to a random variable. Generally, when we talk of summations, we talk of convergence to a real number. For example, when we talked about spectral density, the spectral density is a discrete time Fourier transform of the autocovariance function, that is at least relation wise. And there we straight away said for that summation to converge, that the autocovariance should be absolutely convergent. But what we meant by convergence there is convergence to a real valued number. Here, when we are talking of convergence here, we expect the summation to converge to a random variable. Random variable in the same space as the space on which you are looking at, that is the same sample space on which you are examining the process. And the convergence of sequences of random variables is a lot more involved than the convergence of sequences of real numbers or, you know, deterministic variables. We will not go over the theory of convergence of random variables at this stage. It becomes highly important in estimation theory when we talk of consistency, that is convergence of estimates to the truths and so on. So, I will postpone the discussion of the theory of convergence, but you should know that this summation here just straight away does not necessarily guarantee that the net result is going to be a random variable defined on a certain sample space.